We have a special guest to celebrate our 100th episode. We have Bruce with us here today in the studio.
Thanks, Ben, for setting this up. I'm thrilled to be here.
Well, we're glad to have you here. Bruce, some of your videos have done very, very well and received a lot of attention. In fact, the video with the most views is the Cannabis Light Myths and Facts video. And it has, as of this morning, just under 3 million views. We're about 50,000 views away from reaching 3 million views.
Yeah.
Did you ever think you'd have a video with 3 million views, Bruce?
No, of course not. When things happen in the world, that I guess we could say this went viral, but it's little tiny things that just answer a lot of questions for people.
Yes.
Yeah, and in this field, of course, besieged by advertisements from lighting companies.
Yeah.
Here's our magic spectra. And in science, we don't have a lot of things we call magic.
Yeah, science and magic really are kind of, counterpoints.
Yeah,
for
so
sure.
Here's the principles.
Yeah.
But it's not like buy this light, here's the guiding principles to figure out what kind of lighting you need.
Yeah.
And then you figure it out from the principles. People ask me lots of strange things. I mean, I heard that you should always plant at the full moon. And I don't tell them that's crazy. I tell them, well, we don't have any data to support that.
Yeah.
Oh, and we get sometimes into it that doesn't the lunar pole do something to water? And yes, but these are super minor things. And there's a lot of diet is like that. There's thousands of diet books and people swear by certain diets. Same thing with nutrition in plants. They swear by certain ratios of nutrition.
Yeah.
Whereas we go by just principles of nutrition.
Yeah.
And it is this consistent with the principles that we know.
So Bruce, this is our 100th video. And so along the way, is there any moments that kind of stand out from filming these videos or?
Certainly, one of them is that myths of cannabis lighting video that went viral.
Yeah.
That was my first experience of doing something that became popular. And then you realize that it's not just a number on the screen, but if 1% of those people send me emails, I get a lot of emails. Could you just elaborate on this? And I'm not, and I can't possibly respond to all of them. So my graduate students reply. And that led to us teaching a course at the university. Okay. It's called we're getting ready to teach the third edition of this now. It's called the Science and Technology of Medical Cannabis Cultivation. Yeah. And that's been a big hit with people that really want to dig deep and get into the physiology and genetics
from
of cannabis.
A much deeper level, not just
a deeper level. Yeah.
How is it, Bruce, that you kind of got into research and studying and even starting, a company and building sensors? How did that all happen?
Yeah, people sometimes have asked how do I get started in what I do? And I grew up in a very rural area of Minnesota, Painesville, Minnesota, and I worked on farms as a kid, but my family ran a resort and a family entrepreneurial thing, and everybody worked in the resort. But it wasn't agriculture. And it wasn't until I got to college, I started college in engineering because I was good at math in high school, so you do engineering and mechanical and electrical. And at that time, the students I was there with were pretty straight arrow engineers. The stereotype is a white shirt and a narrow black tie or something.
Very sharp pencils.
And a pocket pull of pencils and maybe a pocket protector and all that stuff. And I took a class in plant biology, and the subject matter fascinated me, but I think I was also drawn by the kind of students that were in that class. They were interested in ecology and lots of different things. And I changed my major at some point and started to just do more plant biology. And then I went to graduate school in plant biology, horticulture. And more specifically, I always wanted to go to California. There was just mystique of there's no absolute truths in California. We reevaluate everything every day, you know, and that to me as a teenager was really interesting.
Really interesting.
So I got into UC Davis to graduate school, and then I really dug into physiology and things, but I was always interested in controlled environments, and it was, for me, it was a synthesis of the engineering. How do you build a box to control the environment to make plants grow faster?
Yeah.
And that's so intriguing with the control systems. And back then, it wasn't a thing to grow food indoors. It was just a research tool. Mm-hmm. We'd build these and we'll understand how to modify the environment, how do plants respond to the environment. It was all about that. And oh gosh, I wrote a paper in a class on this specialized greenhouse. It was called the Morning Glory Greenhouse, but it had big reflective panels that closed at night and opened in the day.
Wow.
And it was all the energy, and it produced a lot of heat because it reflected in, and you could heat all these buildings with the heat, and then at night they closed. And that paper, which was for a class, got picked up by a journal called Alternative Sources of Energy, and they said, we'd like to publish this paper. And it was before computers, and it had all these calculations and hand-drawn pictures, and that got published. That was my first publication.
Oh, really? Wow.
Then that led to me getting an offer for an assistantship, a research assistantship at Penn State University. So off I go between California and Pennsylvania to get a PhD.
Wow.
And it was focused on controlled environment agriculture. And that led to me getting a position at Utah State University, coming here. Now I have more money and to do more things. We got a big grant funded by NASA early in my career, and that launched a lot of things. Now, wow, we're doing this stuff for NASA.
Yeah.
Along the way, measuring light was huge because of all the environmental parameters, we can measure temperature, humidity, CO2 better than the plants can sense them.
Oh, wow.
But light, the plants sense that better than our best instruments.
Hmm.
So, wow, there was a really great opportunity to do precision light measurement. And the sensors were expensive.
Hmm.
And I thought, well, I'm going to fiddle around with this. And so I built, not even in my garage, at my kitchen table, built some light meters with photodiodes and modified voltmeters, and I just built them for my lab.
So you didn't have a background understanding of electronics?
I had enough of an engineering background, yeah. I knew the basics of...
You knew how to...
I knew Ohm's Law.
Well, that's what you need.
Vehicles IR.
Yeah.
And I, you know, how do I do resistors? And so people came to visit the lab, and we had these sensors, and they go, well, they were friends, and could you build me one? And sure. So I built them one. And then I start to get phone calls from people say, I just saw this sensor, this meter in somebody's lab, and it's terrific. Could you build me one? You don't know me, but I'll pay for it. So I went to the university, and I said, well, there's a market here for these meters, and I'd like to build them, the meters, at home and sell them, and I'd like to set up a separate account to keep track of the money.
Yeah.
And the university said, no, you can't do that. We don't want the liability issues, and we don't want the criticism that we're competing unfairly.
Oh, okay.
But the solution is we'll help you start a company, and we'll give you space in our research park.
Well, there you go.
And cool, but guess what that meant? We'll take half the money.
Oh.
And I say, nah, I'm gonna keep making them at my kitchen table.
My,
I don't need you.
Pretty good at that point.
And there we go. And then it grew and had to build a new garage, much bigger. And we were in my garage for 8 or 10 years and we weren't trying to grow fast, but we kept, and then we just got too big. And then we built this much nicer building, and it's gone from there. So there was no bank loan. There was no investors. You know, I put thousands of dollars of my own money into it. We didn't have a bank loan to pay back.
Yeah.
You know, we didn't. And because of that, there was the whole company and all the early employees started just with a passion to build good meters. And
people really like your cannabis videos. How did you get involved with cannabis?
Because we had a reputation for doing precise work in highly controlled environments, cannabis growers came to us and said, in North America, in the United States, we need help growing a better quality crop. You've got all the infrastructure to do this. Could we give you funding to do cannabis? And until 2018, the university, my lab at the university said, no, we can't take their money. It's illegal. Yeah. It's federally illegal, and we'll get in big trouble. So in December 2017, I think that was the exact month and year, that the Farm Bill passed, and it made low THC cannabis legal, federally legal. Now, that's commonly called hemp, but we just call it low THC cannabis. You can't get high from it. And at that moment, the university said, okay, now it's we'll take their money to work on low THC cannabis. And we got a license, both from the state of Utah and from the USDA to do this, and much more security, things like that. Off we go with funding from growers. Because at the time, there's no federal funding, there's no state funding. That's a normal place people like me get money.
Yeah.
It's public agencies. These are private companies. Started doing lot of research, applying all the things we know to cannabis. And well, some of my colleagues said, oh my, this is a brand new crop, we're starting from zero. We said, no, this is the crop like any other. It has the same biochemistry, it has the same photoperiod requirements. Let's look at the things that are unique. And that helps us focus the research on things that we didn't know, that were different. And of course, that led to some pretty rapid progress in publications. And pretty soon, you're getting invited to conferences to speak on this, because you went from nothing to the expert, because the bar was so low. There isn't anybody else working on this at universities. So that was a big jump start for the cannabis research. And we have continued to do the NASA research all along. But the NASA research is purely food crops, and the cannabis research is just cannabis.
So through your research, did you ever have something that popped up? You're like, oh, this is interesting.
Yeah, so I think the public thinks science progresses when people say, Eureka, I found it. And that's not true. The phrase that I think is the most common is looking at data and go, that's funny. why did this happen like this? And then the ability to say, this is not just experimental error. There's something here that's real.
Did you have any of those moments?
Oh, it happened all the time.
All the time.
And one of my favorite quotes is from Louis Pasteur. He says, chance favors the prepared mind. Mm. And so if you know what you're looking for, you could look at patterns of data and separate experimental error from novel responses.
So Bruce, right now, as a researcher and the owner of Apogee, what kind of questions do you have at night? what kind of things keep you up?
many. and they're often driven by growers that they call with things that can't be explained. And some of them you can explain, many you can, but their responses you can't explain. So it isn't always your own data, it's somebody else's data that we're seeing this. And so those lead us to do tests on those things, which of course helps those growers enormously.
Yeah.
There are lots of complex interactions. Here's a really good example. We knew from reading the literature from 60 to 70 years ago that there was evidence that cannabis was exceptionally sensitive to light pollution. Mm-hmm. You know, like some people can sleep with the lights on, some people can't. They have to have it all dark. So it's intuitive. Well, some plants that can have the lights on, it doesn't matter, and some plants got to have it dark. And so it suggested cannabis was exquisitely sensitive to light pollution. So we start doing some tests, and wow, we confirm this old research, which hadn't been done for a while. It's really sensitive. Well, how are you going to measure this? Well, there's an instrument. So that led to Apogee building this light pollution detector.
So that's where that came from.
And everybody measures light in what we call micromoles.
Yeah.
It's 10 to the minus 6 moles. All of a sudden, We build a meter to measure nanomoles, 10 to minus 9, 1,000 times more sensitive, to measure these and quantify them. And that's been a huge help to growers who need what we call reagent grade darkness night. You know, that's an interesting term that we coined.
Yeah.
Poinsettia is a real sensitive crop to light pollution too, to make the bracts turn red. Yeah. It's a real common crop. And we always said they are our most sensitive crop, but now we've shown cannabis even more sensitive.
Wow. Well, thank you for watching. Thank you, Bruce, for taking the time and filming with me for a little bit. If you want to learn more about Bruce and his research, click on this playlist, and it'll show you more of the things that he's taught us, and you can learn a lot from him as well. So thank you very much for coming, Bruce.
And, thank you, Ben.
We'll see you later.
Great. Thank you. Bye.